Good afternoon, everybody. It's wonderful to be with you today. Thank you for joining us. I am grateful for your attendance on this Thursday afternoon. I hope you are all doing really, really well. My name is Michael Robertson. I teach anthropology here, and I'm also serving as the online education faculty coordinator, which is just that really long title that means I get to serve faculty like you as we navigate the world of online teaching together. So I'm happy to be here and appreciative for you being here too. I want to get into a couple items of housekeeping before we jump into our wonderful presentation this afternoon. I want to begin with just the friendly reminder that this meeting is being recorded. As you heard when I started that recording, some of our colleagues cannot be with us this afternoon, but they hope to catch it later on YouTube. So that's why we're recording and posting this there for their viewing pleasure. Also, please feel free to jump in and use the chat function throughout this presentation. I will be making note of any questions that pop up there. And we're also going to have a designated Q&A portion at the very end of this presentation, probably the last 10 to 15 minutes or so, where we can unmute. I'll stop the recording and have a little bit more of a dialogue there. Also, we do have the closed captions enabled for this meeting. If you'd like to turn those on, just click that CC button at the bottom of your Zoom screen, and those will appear for you. Okay, so again, just housekeeping items as we all are used to in these wonderful Zoom workshops. All right, with that, allow me to set the scene for just a moment. The best way that I know how is to tell you all again that I sincerely love online teaching. And I'm not being facetious, I really do love it. As your online education faculty coordinator, I get to help faculty all around the college as we continue to hone our skills in the online teaching and learning space. And that's really, really fun and sometimes very, very challenging and often very rewarding. But one of my favorite parts of this job is when faculty come to me with their success stories. And they tell me, oh, Michael, I did this really neat thing in my Canvas shell. Can I show it to you? And I was like, yes, I'll drop everything to see what you are proud of, because I think that positive reinforcement is really, really important, especially for online instructors. And that's what got me thinking we need to do more showcase work. And that's where this workshop series came from, where I've reached out to some of our top online teachers at the college and ask them, hey, would you be willing to share your exemplary online course with our colleagues so that they can get some inspiration of your successes in the online teaching space? So that's why we're here. I appreciate you being here. And I sincerely hope that you can share even just a little bit of the enthusiasm that our presenter is going to bring with us today. It certainly inspires me and makes me want to do my job even better every single time I log into Canvas. So with that, I am going to introduce our esteemed presenter today. Her name is Desiree Ann Montenegro, and she is a communication studies and speech instructor at several community colleges in California and serves as an affiliate faculty with the California Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation Education. She specializes in distance learning for diverse and specialized student populations. Desiree earned her BA and MA degrees from Cal State LA, and her undergrad degree is in comm studies, emphasizing in public relations and organizational communication. Her master's degree is also in comm studies, focusing on public communication. Desiree has also completed the Long Beach City College Peer Online Course Review, or Poker process, for her Comm 10 course, Elements of Public Speaking. And I see plenty of Comm instructors here today. Glad you can come out and support. Additionally, Desiree is certified in online teaching and trained in developing and using OER, or Open Educational Resources, and Creative Commons licensed materials for instructional purposes. She's also serving as the membership chair in CHAI, the part-time faculty union here at the college. It is my absolute pleasure to introduce our speaker, Desiree Montenegro. Desiree, the floor is yours. Thank you for being here.
Hi, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here and to share a little bit about what I've done in my classes with all of you today. Bear with me for a couple seconds as I jump into a course. that I have prepared for all of us to take a look at is part of this online teaching showcase. And so I really wish I could cover absolutely everything that I have learned and gleaned from so many wonderful faculty in our department and folks on our campus, the supporting faculty. But perhaps maybe this will be a follow-up workshop, or perhaps if you'd like to contact me outside of this workshop, I'm happy to share any information that I can with you. So I chose just to pluck out some stuff that I feel that really stands out in terms of the effort that you put into it versus the benefit that students get out of just implementing different ideas, approaches, and strategies for online teaching. So I want to start off with the agenda just to sort of highlight some of the things that I'm going to go over today in the presentation portion of the workshop. So the first thing is I do want to sort of start and clarify what is an overview of the presentation portion, but also what are my objectives in terms of my participation in this workshop. So I'll go ahead and share that with you in a few minutes. The second thing that I'm going to go over in the presentation is what my workshop goals are. So what are my personal professional goals in terms of what I'm hoping that everyone can get out of today's workshop? I hope to inspire, I hope to share, and I certainly hope to motivate fellow faculty who also teach online through this visual showcase of my public speaking course here at Long Beach City College. The third thing that I'm going to go over is the course design. So for me, course design matters, and it really is dependent on the content, the discipline, and the students that you are delivering this instructional material and content to. And so the course design that I prefer for the public speaking course is a linear design. And so I'll share a little bit more about why I've made that choice. And the second thing that I'll talk about is the website logic. So I sort of approached taking this course and designing this course, understanding that our students are consumers of websites and various messages on online platforms. And so there are things that they're used to in terms of how they receive the information. So I definitely adopt and borrow from best practices in terms of website design in order to make sure that the information is available and accessible for our students and consumable so they can synthesize it and learn, because that's the overall goal. Then I'm going to highlight one representative module. That's going to be the very first module in this course, and that module is all about rhetoric and public speaking. So I believe that's really a representative model because there's a variety of strategies that I utilize in this specific course and that have gone into and influenced the design of this course that I really feel are representative in the very first module. So we'll go over that in a few minutes. And then I'm going to conclude by recapping some of the things that we went over in the workshop and hoping that you all feel encouraged and can utilize some of the information I shared with you today, some important and very necessary acknowledgments of everyone who has played a really significant part in me being able to be here today and share this class with you. And then, of course, we'll have the 15-minute Q&A, as Michael had mentioned earlier. And thank you so much, Michael, for serving as my tech person, keeping an eye on the chat, and letting me know if anyone has any questions. I'm going to go ahead and navigate to that representative module now to sort of share with you a little bit more in depth about the things that I have done. So before I get straight into it, I just wanted to provide sort of a visual here. So you can sort of see I follow this module format. I always tell students who are transitioning from in-person classes and having traditional textbooks, I try to make the connection for them. And I say, if you read a textbook and you see that there's chapters in the textbook, just think about the modules as chapters. And then something sort of clicks for them and they get it. But so structure, arrangement, and organization really can matter for students. So obviously I'm here today showcasing this representative sample that I plucked from the content elements of public speaking course that I teach here at Long Beach City College. CID is COM 110. It is poker certified, and I'm hoping to share this obviously with all of you who are attending today. I'm appreciative that you've attended, but also because it will be available on the YouTube channel, I'm hoping to that it's beneficial for all faculty who are able to view it. You already know what the peer online course review process is, but I do want to highlight that it is voluntary, and it is really aimed at assisting faculty in enhancing the quality of their online instruction and their courses. And it certainly has been a resource that has supported me as an online teacher here at Long Beach City College. My goal is that through this digital showcase, I hope to inspire, to inform, and to motivate. So now that we got the objectives and the goals out of the way, let's get straight into the course design and website logic. So you'll notice there's an introductory module, and then I have a module one, which I'll be getting to in a bit, and then I have a module two. So let me stop here really quick and explain the design, the linear design. So there's various reasons why linear design is a really good approach for online instruction, primarily because it's sequential, progressive. It's simple, in my opinion. It's also straightforward. It can reveal concepts and ideas progressively and really can help prevent something I call information overload, which I'm cognizant of all the time because I was a student at some point in my life. I always go back to that experience and chime into that personal experience to be able to relate to my students. It also helps to increase understanding and information retention. So, for example, in a class like this, where we're teaching public speaking skills, but we're also introducing students to these grandiose theories about communication and behavior, it's really important sort of to build on things. So, one will create a foundation for what they'll be expected to perform on, learn, do, and read in module two and so forth. And that's the reason why linear design really works well for this course. When we're talking about website logic, there's a couple of things. So I'm going to get into my first module content page, which is module outline and outcomes, as I'm sort of talking through this. So as you can see, I have some design elements over here. I also have something that I'll refer to in a bit, and it's called a call-out box. But I have a variation of different kinds of information sort of arranged differently. I have module outcomes, I have course outcomes addressed, and of course, at the very beginning of every module, I connect it with our student learning outcomes so that students can understand that there are overall takeaways, and I connect that to other information they may be exposed to about the class, like the course description and catalog description and the listing of the class and the schedule and so forth. So when I'm talking about web logic, again, we understand that our students are consumers of websites. They are exposed to websites. So I look at things like usability. I look at things like content strategy. So the extent to which we are arranging, selecting, and displaying various kinds of information from call-out boxes to And I'll go to the next page so you can see some variation, call out boxes to imagery. Now, when it comes to various kinds of information, the challenge with embedding videos is that in some cases the video is inactive. So then you'll have to continually be looking into your content pages for inactive videos to replace them, perhaps, or to remove them. So images are a much more stable kind of image. And so I find that images combined with call-out boxes can really sort of do the very same thing that a video can do. So usability, the practice of creating a site, which is the way I sort of look at my classes sometimes, in a way that's intuitive and easy to understand for students. So this comes down to, choosing images that perhaps maybe will call their attention, have appropriate and appealing color contrast or something that they may already be familiar with, like New York Times and other images that may sort of call out to them, like an actual, an actual a sort of comedic script or image or GIF or something that will call their attention. I'll add in there. So that's what I mean by usability. So what I mean by content strategy is, again, referring to the planning process, the creation, the distribution, and the management of that information, because there is a management component that a lot of people don't realize in online teaching that has to go into up continually updating your information, refreshing it, perhaps maybe finding new examples. And one of the ways that I can tap into how students are interacting and perceiving my information is a couple of things. So one of the things that I do is called a learning experience survey. I have one at the beginning of the term and I have one at the end. And I invite students to give me feedback and to let me know how they're receiving the information and what their overall experience is like so far. And that allows me the space that I need to make necessary updates because their perspective and opinion is really valuable because they're the ones navigating through the information for learning purposes. And the last thing in terms of like a website logic approach to this course is your course mobile friendly? So does your information translate from the desktop website to the smartphone using the Canvas app? This is really important because we can't all assume that students have a computer, right? And so some of our students are navigating and taking courses, submitting and completing assignments on their smartphones. And so one of the ways you can check if your information is translating is you can actually go into your test student on the Canvas app on your smartphone. And now it gets tricky when you have an Android versus an Apple-based or Mac-based smartphone. There may be some variations there in the functionality of the Canvas app, but not much. And so that's a great way to sort of see what your students are seeing. Does it translate? So now that we've covered the course design and website logic, let's dive into the next few content pages, which I really believe are more representative of really some of the stuff that I've done here. So you can see here already, I'll scroll up, I'll try not to go too fast. This is in fact a Creative Commons image that I use. All the images that I use in my course are in fact Creative Commons images. And so it's important to use these kind of images because first and foremost, these images have a license that allows them to be used in various purposes, specifically instructional purposes, I find. And there are variations within Creative Commons image licenses. Some images will allow you to use it freely. Some images will put some specific instructions, like you can't use it for profit and so on and so forth. So if you're interested in learning more about Creative Commons images, there is a course you can take that's available. And I've linked a Creative Commons imagery, a link in the my go-to online teaching resources, which I'll ask Michael to post in the chat in a few minutes. So you'll have that direct link if you're interested in finding out more. Also, the implementation of these call-out boxes, it may seem simple, but sort of taking the learner's eye away from the text and sort of calling their attention to this call-out box can really highlight key information. It could be a really much needed visual component that provides some invited distraction that can really help students guide their eye to why is the instructor sharing this image with me and how does it connect with the content that I just read. Sort of an interesting side note, when I first was exposed to call-out boxes, it was actually in the traditional sense as a pre-med student at Cal State LA many, many moons ago, prior to declaring my major as communication studies, we had a lot of textbooks that had a lot of content that was very heavy, a lot of memorization, and it was really interesting, but there were times where sometimes my attention would waver. And having those call-out boxes, I found to be really valuable as a pre-med student because it really allowed me a moment in time, in space, to be distracted and to guide my eye to something visual, perhaps. And so obviously I found myself in the arts for a reason because I'm visually oriented and I love art and I love visual aspects of learning. And so that carries into a lot of the things that I do in terms of translating these call-out boxes in an online course. Strategies for fostering peer-to-peer interaction. I'm going to navigate outside of this module very quickly, and I am going to actually share something with you that I myself had my own version a long time ago, but thanks to the distance learning team and thanks to Michael, I'm sure he was a key part of this, and perhaps our chair of the communications department, Doug Raphael, who's here today, and many other people put together information that is sort of a template. When you have a course assignment that pops up on your dashboard, you'll automatically have a course with some set template content. And so I actually adopted this from some of the material that was provided in that template content because I actually liked it better than the one I originally had, which provides a really important space for students sort of to foster peer-to-peer sharing of information, but also really to help facilitate an environment where they can create a sense of community, which sometimes can be a challenge in asynchronous and synchronous courses. So this is a really important part to one of the strategies that I use to motivate students to interact with each other and to share information and create community. Also, another thing that I do sort of to foster creative interaction and collaboration is the blogs that are connected to every module assignment. And so that is a traditional discussion that you could just go in. And again, it's very much modeled after this student hangout forum. And every blog has two peer-to-peer requirements. So you're expected to respond to a blog and to reply to two peers. There's also something I didn't mention in the notes that I'll ask Michael to share with you in a bit, compiled sort of a note section with the resources in a PDF document, is the peer evaluation of speeches. So that's another thing that I do specifically for this class, public speaking, that I find is really beneficial because the feedback I'll give students in terms of evaluation and grade is one thing, and they have clear guidance in terms of grading rubric and such, but their peers can give them really valuable information as well. So having both of those can really help a student develop their public speaking skills in a way that's very well-rounded. And sometimes they may be receptive, right, to their peers' opinion because they don't have that evaluation component that's part of the instructor and student feedback process. Okay, so now that we've reviewed a little bit about this representative sample, I'll go back to the module so we could see it. Of some of the things that I've done in my online class teaching public speaking, let's go ahead and conclude. So thank you for attending. I wish I could have gone over everything. I feel like this is sort of like a mini light workshop, and I'm happy to share more information with you about some of the things that I've done, and various resources that are my go-to resources for online teaching. But we only have so much time. So thank you for being here today. I'm going to ask Michael at this time to go ahead and copy and paste that text that I had put in the chat earlier of my go-to resources. And then I will explain them a little bit, and then I will continue. So first one is color enumeration, emojis, because students love them, why not use them? There's a colorblind checker link there that connects with accessibility, and a Creative Commons imagery link as well, and a link to LibreText, which is a link to open education resource textbooks that you can very conveniently create an export and very seamlessly import into your Canvas courses. Number six on that list is connect with Canvas and ask questions. An actual community question forum where you can ask any question if you're teaching a class online, and you'd be surprised on how many people will jump in and answer the question and be very supportive and provide resources. So tap into your community of practice, tap into the Canvas question forum. People are very helpful. And then the last but not least is check our Canvas Commons course for inspiration and ideas, because I frequently do. I'm constantly learning. Remember that the distance education landscape is ever-changing, so be flexible. Utilize local, state, national resources. Stay plugged into your community of practice because it's really an extremely valuable component of teaching online. I'd also like to express my gratitude to the LBCC poker team, particularly to Michael Robertson, the poker lead. I learned so much from you. I'm so grateful for the poker review and feedback that you provided. I have carried so many of the things that you've taught me on to my teaching. I am forever grateful. And Douglas Raphael, who's the chair of the Communication Studies Department and Course Evaluation Subcommittee Chair, as well as a peer reviewer, and the rest of the poker team, who also played a very important part in my experience in the poker certification process. Again, thank you for your invaluable feedback, and I am forever grateful. And that's the that will end the presentation portion of our workshop. So I would like to now open up the floor for questions. I'm a little early on that in the agenda, Michael, I know, but perhaps maybe we can have some questions and have a little bit more time for that interaction. I'm going to go ahead and stop sharing.
Absolutely. Thank you, Desiree, for sharing that with us. And And since we do have a little bit more time, I was really hoping that you could show us a couple more areas of your course, if that's okay. We would love to see the homepage, what students see as soon as they log in. We'd love to see maybe an assignment, and maybe you can walk us through your thought process on building a couple of those. Would that be okay?
I would love to. Yeah, let me go ahead and start sharing. And
By
you'll
all
just see a
means,
little bit
please
of
go
a,
ahead.
it'll be a little bit of a jump screen is what my kids like to call it.
Okay.
Okay. So this is the home page. So I usually have it set up so that the students could see three most recent announcements. I do post weekly announcements, which I tell them are their guiding instructions, or think about it as like your driving instructions for the week. I do include direct links to assignments to try to make it easy for students to follow. So I always tell them, look at the announcement. And then my homepage, of course, is what about this course do I need to know? What matters? Catalog description, again, consistency in messaging can be really important for students. And I also provide sort of a central hub for students to navigate. I tell them to start here because I think that's the most common question. Where do I start, right? So start here. I also have a link to the syllabus, which will take them to where the syllabus lives in the navigation bar. And then modules, more resources, and student technology help desk because it is an online class after all. And then communication expectations to help students manage and let them know when they should anticipate a response from their instructor. So I will go into the Start Here page first. So again, this is very introductory. It just tells them this is why you're here. This is what the class is. It's an online asynchronous. I think that's really important for students to know, like, is there a Zoom component that's required? If there isn't, I try to make that clear from the onset. So there's to prevent normative confusion. So students know what's expected of them and if they need to be somewhere at a specific time. I share with them that I'm using open education resources because I want them to know, yay, you don't have to buy a textbook. And so they tend to really like that. And then I share some important dates with them. So typically this would be when the class starts and when it ends, even though that's listed on their schedule. It'd be very helpful to have that information here at the onset. And then if there's any Zoom classes that are required, I typically will put that underneath there. Technical support is really important. And then, so now we've started and I'm logged in. Now, what do I do? So, that language and guiding the student could be really helpful. And as you can see here, I have, well, you started the login page. Let's get into the syllabus and then make sure that you finish the quest for online success Canvas training to support your success in the course. And then, of course, if you're interested, take a look at the assignments because these are the deliverables and this is what's going to be expected of you. All right, so let's go back to the home page so I can navigate to the second link. So we have our syllabus. And so I usually will build the syllabus in here, and then I will have a clickable link where students can actually download the syllabus. So whenever possible, I try to provide material in different forms, right? So I'll try to have a PDF, I'll try to have a Word document, also try to have it in a content page. So multiple formats can be really helpful for students who are navigating on different devices, but also who may have different learning styles as well. So course objective, catalog description, student learning outcomes, objectives, required textbooks. And this might take me a while to go over, so I'll stop at a certain point and navigate to the next part of the class. But letting them know how many speeches, because this is a speech class, that is really the core focus of this class. I want them to know how many speeches you have, how many points are they worth, and so forth, so students could plan ahead. Because I understand that they're not just students, they also have lives outside of class so that they could manage their time wisely. And then I have coursework guidelines, how many speeches, the peer review components, so on and so forth, and the direct link to the online, the Quest 3.0 online learning student success training. So I'm going to go into my modules now so we could take a look at that. So I'm going to collapse all my modules very quickly. And then I will go ahead and open up my second module, which is the one that we didn't get to see. And I'll sort of navigate from page to page in the order that they're listed. So about this module, that can be really important because that sort of sets the stage for students about like what are we supposed to learn here and what is this module about? Let me see if I can navigate to the next page. So digital communication is one of the first things that we talk about in this second module. So I'll have a call-out box again to highlight some content. We talk about the narrative architecture, the medium, and the message. Call-out box again, a compelling image. We talk about journalism, citizen journalism, new media, propaganda machines, the war of the narrative. So this is really where we're getting into narrative structures. And we get into some specific scholars in our field that really speak to this part of these concepts within this class, some more imagery. And so now that you sort of see and the references, because sometimes students are interested and they want to dive in a little deeper. And so having a list of references could be really helpful at every content page. So let me go ahead and go into assignments. Because I remember Michael saying that that might be something that we want to share. So the very first assignment that I didn't have a chance to open is the module one assignment. Now remember, this module is a module where we're talking about rhetoric and public speaking. And so this module assignment is all about it's basically a rhetorical analysis. And what I'll do in my assignments is I'll put the objective way up so that the students know exactly what's expected of them or what they can anticipate to get out of this assignment. And then I'll usually have a step-by-step instruction. So as a student, I remember step-by-step being very valuable. And so I try to, again, pass that understanding to students. I also have hyperlinks for students. So I'll tell them, choose a speech that you want to study. So there's a database here that I refer students to. It's a free speech database where students can go on there and explore various speeches. The speeches are recorded, and there's also transcripts that are available for these various speeches. And it's free. And then I'll tell them to review it or watch it a couple times. And then they want to look at three things. So look for three things called appeals. I'll have them because in this at this point they've read about appeals to emotion. So audience appeals to emotion, audience appeals to ethics, audience appeals to logic and the way of thinking of problem solving. And so I'll have them look at these speeches, review these speeches, and pluck out the various components of the messages or the overall message that's related to appeals directed towards audiences' ethics or pathos or logos. So this is a direct application of what they're reading. So a lot of the module assignments have direct applications to the material that they've reviewed. And then I give them a little bit of guidance, again, a step-by-step on how to organize the information. And then I will remind them about, you know, what it is that they should be looking for, and so on and so forth. And then, of course, one of the things that I always remind them of is, well, how do I format this information? So I'll tell them how to format it. And then I will always have a don't forget component of each assignment. And so that provides sort of instructional support and links to things like templates, to things like reminders in various modules that are related to this assignment or the content. And so I've created about three instructional support modules that are not modules where students are expected to read and they're not assigned to them, but they what lives in them is basically supporting material, things like templates, things like links and resources, and how-tos and such. And those are usually always at the bottom. If a student needs a template or a template could be useful, I will link that module and I'll link the template itself at the bottom. So students have some kind of visual guide to know how where to start. And then of course I always have grading rubrics. So what I find to be very valuable for students is I always tell them, look at the grading rubrics. This is what I'm looking for as I'm grading your assignment. Please make sure that you use this as a checklist. And I'm also able to provide general feedback, but then also a specific feedback. So at any point in time, it looks like they should really met the assignment, but there's one particular thing that they have room to grow. I'll make sure to make a specific comment about that to provide them the room to continue to grow and to improve in that specific skill set. So that's just one assignment. I'm going to go to the assignment set so you can see all the assignments that I have listed. So I have them subdivided by the kind of assignment that they are for students to have that clarity. So training and survey and check-in assignments are usually in this category. And that's things like a quest for online student success training, which is a requirement in all my courses. And then I'll have students submit like a screenshot of the completion or the certificate if they receive one. And then I'll have them do a syllabus orientation quiz. And then, of course, those learning experience quizzes that I referred to earlier. And one of the ways that I've been really able to incentivize students to complete their SLO assessments on online classes is actually making it a requirement. So then I will tell students that they have to complete it, and then that way they actually have that incentive to complete it. And so I create an entire assignment to remind them. And also, what lives here is instructions that I'm given from my department, like things like what is the code for that SLO, for those SLO assessment quizzes. And so I'm able to provide all of that information for the students in that assignment. And then, like I said, I have various module assignments. So every module has an accompanying application activity or module assignment. And so you'll see here that using the naming convention that's similar with the module reading can really be helpful in allowing students to recognize that module one assignment is connected with module one reading, module two assignment, and so on and so forth. So another assignment that I typically have in this course is discuss an online speech example. In the past, I used to use an external tool called Flip. Before that, it was called Flipgrid. It's a blogging platform that's free. It's no longer supported. So at this moment in time, I was able to convert this into a discussion space. But there are various external tools that we can use that may be similar or even better than Flip. And so, if you are having students view a video, asking them to create a blog response to that video, reflect on some of the concepts learned in the module, you can certainly have them do that this way. And I'll click on this so you can sort of see. Students now have the ability to reply on here, and they can also copy like a URL to a video that they record from any platform. It could be Canva or it could be YouTube as unlisted and so forth. So students could put that straight in there and then provide a video that is viewable for everyone to see. So that's one way that could be done, and it's all housed in the same space. I'm all about trying to create an experience for students where everything is in one central place, so they're not required or even need to navigate outside of the Canvas course. I find that could be really beneficial. Let me go back to the assignments. Another assignment, and I think I have maybe time, Michael, right, for one more assignment. Would you prefer I show? Let me show a speech assignment because, after all, our speech assignments are really the core of this course. So let me go ahead and show the very first speech. So one of the things early on in teaching public speaking that I found students were really struggling with is how can I create an online virtual speech? And so for many, this was the very first time they were expected to do this, and there was a learning curve. So I discovered that providing students sort of a low stakes opportunity in the form of a first speech called the tech rehearsal speech, students would have an opportunity to sort of practice with the technology that they are comfortable with and that they prefer to use to create a virtual speech. So that's what this assignment is. And I have every speech assignment broken or divided into various steps so it's easy for students to follow. So the tech rehearsal speech is exactly that. They record a speech, they generate a URL share link, and they submit it in this assignment. The tech rehearsal speech is basically just practice. It's a dry run for them to practice how to deliver a virtual speech. They're given a time frame, they're given some helpful hints, some cues, some best practices. But ultimately, they get to choose a platform that they want to use. It could be Canva presentation, it could be YouTube as unlisted, or any other free resource. I have some other examples there too. Sometimes I'll have students who will share it from a Google Drive and so forth. And then I also have a really important part about helping students manage their communication apprehension. So one of the biggest things we have to deal with in public speaking is perhaps maybe students are apprehensive or nervous because they're not sure how to deliver a virtual speech, but maybe even on top of that, they're a little nervous because maybe they have an apprehension towards speaking in front of people in general. And so some of the things that I provide here is what causes communication apprehension, how people can overcome it. There are various approaches, but I sort of plucked out the general, most applicable, and most beneficial for students, like deep breathing, focusing on the audience, maintaining a sense of humor, and then sort of walking them through how to overcome that apprehension. And then I remind them to be courageous because that's important as well, and to be themselves. And again, every single assignment has a don't forget section for them to really have those resources to support their success in every assignment, but also in the class. Step two is typically the outline or the essay. I give students an either-or option. Sometimes I'll have students who have a lot of experience in writing outlines, so I'll let them choose that comfort level so that they have that confidence going into this step of the process. Sometimes they're more comfortable with essays, and so I provide them with various templates based on their choice. Then they'll have a step three, which is typically that peer-to-peer feedback. I utilize discussion, the discussion feature in Canvas to provide students a one space to be able to share their videos, their URLs, but also to reply to each other and provide some feedback. I also allow them to do that via messaging as well. And so the first speech only has three steps. The other speeches have, on average, two more steps, and typically that has to do with the more that's related to if the speech is more complex or a little bit more difficult, I'll have an additional step for example, perhaps maybe a draft for the forensic speech. Persuasive speeches could be a little harder, so I'll have the students submit a draft, like a take a look at it, give them some preliminary feedback, and then they can navigate with a little bit more confidence moving forward. But typically, every speech has, on average, 3 to 5 steps. I think they're good on time for the Q&A now. Is
You
that
are
good
perfect
information?
on time. You are perfect. Yes. Let's take a moment, clap your real or digital hands. Thank you, Desiree, for the wonderful, wonderful presentation. It really, really interesting stuff. We're going to jump to Q&A in a moment. I'm going to stop the recording for that. Before I stop the recording, again, I want to thank Desiree one more time. I also want to shamelessly plug the YouTube channel, which has our previous workshops in this series. I'm also going to paste the link to that YouTube playlist in the chat for you. Be sure you check out our previous presenters, Professor Tricia Wilging and Dr. Edward Chen, to learn from two more exemplary online instructors what they do in their classes. Again, thank you for tuning in. Thank you, Desiree, for the presentation. I'm going to stop that recording and get to some questions.